second thing, these breaks, kinds of ruptures between images and then recontextualizing them that you find in collage. That's a big part of my work. I brought some collages, but I think of all my work as kind of operating in that way. I'm very interested in the ordinary, the banal, the mundane things. That fits into a kind of collage process as well, where you find ordinary materials. But that extends into other areas, too, of my practice as an artist. And I'm interested in irony, things saying one thing and meaning another, or things not really meaning what they seem to mean. Part of that is about kind of visual play and puns. Play is a really important part of my interest, and a kind of sense of humor in my work. And that gives me often a very dumb sense of humor. I'm interested in dumbness. And I think that when we do something kind of intentionally, kind of maybe ironically dumb, we can also get at its kind of opposition. What is the profound? Sometimes dumb things make us think of profound things. And I'm interested in that kind of oppositional kind of play. Well, these four things are really big in my work, and I kind of get at them through things like small narrative adventures in my head when I'm working, and also through collage. My talk isn't going to be all text. This is the first time I've ever done this. I've never had text slides before, but I thought that'd be cool. I don't have to use notes then, and usually it gets more formal when I have all these notes. Anyway, like I said, collage is made through this radical de- and recontextualization. It emphasizes contingency over necessity, sort of these things that don't have to be that way, or you're aware when you're arranging pieces of things into something new that they could go in lots of different ways, lots of different directions, even chance. And I like that aspect of collage. It's characterized by citation, quotation, reference. When you take something to a place, it always carries with it wherever it came from. And so there's that kind of tearing something out, or it sounds kind of violent, sort of ruptured, but sometimes it's gentle when you make a collage. That kind of removal and putting into a new place it still refers back to its old place. That's what I mean by citation and reference. And that process is one of the things that makes collage so much a semiotic process. It's all about science. We're very conscious of what these little pieces of things mean when we decontextualize them, because we get to look at them kind of fresh and kind of, there's some, with the disorientation of shifting context, it makes us see it kind of in a, for what it is, for itself. It's all, you could say it, a fragment becomes about itself when you remove the context and create a new one. So I like that about collage. Its sources are often ordinary, and this, like I mentioned before, is that the ordinary and the mundane are kind of recurring things in my work. Collage lends itself to humor very much. When you put two things together that don't belong together, there's a lot of play. Sometimes it's not funny, sometimes it can be pretty nasty, but it lends itself to these kind of ironic issues, and I love visual puns, and you'll see a lot of it in this work if you look for it. And finally, collage is one of the central aesthetic features of contemporary culture, and that really interests me. Motherwell said that collage was the greatest artistic innovation of the 20th century. And just think about it. Before, say, the first decade of the 20th century, when collage wasn't really a practice although it, some people argue that it was a vernacular practice, people did a kind of scrapbooking and so on. It wasn't a kind of high art practice until Cubism, or it didn't become really important until then, if it did exist. That innovation changed everything. Prior to the 20th century, the early 20th century, as Roger Shattuck talks about in the Banquet Years, in his book about that era, art was all about transition, all about creating unities of getting from one place to another in an artwork, in say a painting. And these issues of transition were the major sorts of art sort of moves in constructing formally an image. After collage, it was all about, Shattuck says, juxtaposition, things being pushed together without any kind of transition. And that showed up immediately, not just in the visual arts where you could say it started, but in poetry, in music, in performance, in theater. It became pervasive in all of the arts, this kind of radical juxtapositioning. And it's present today in really big ways in the popular music culture, like hip hop and so on, the way things are quoted and recycled in all of the popular arts. A really dismal postcard. If you saw the postcard, it's a kind of shredded palm trees with a beach and water that blurs together and covers more than half of the postcard, with these umbrellas that look like radioactive warning signs on it. I love that postcard. And this one is a retirement village. This is called Comparing Theories. It's a retirement village in suburban Chicago. You can see the X's and O's come out of the image. You see the O and the bottom. And there's these patterns and systems of overlaying. They're very simple. I also had played with text for a long time, of degrading text to the point where I couldn't read it by feeding it through as a photocopier over and over and over. I would do whole paragraphs from books that I was interested in to try to find a moment that system of signs, that's text, broke down and I couldn't. I was convinced I couldn't read it, although I already knew what it was, so it was hard to find that moment. But I think it's pretty accurate, because some people can read it, some people can't. And so I would put these words across things in these strange kind of degraded text signs. Can you read that?
Is it logical?
Uh-huh. You all see that? It's logical.
Who said
that? This is called Enlightenment Values. It's Williams, Colonial Williamsburg. I did a series of larger ones of Michigan postcards for a show I had in Michigan. I never had the show. It got canceled. I had the show, but they didn't want this series. Strange. This one's called Finding Order in Nature. The gulls are on that postcard. This one is called Sweeping Clean. These are considerably bigger than the other ones. That's a postcard of tulip time in Holland with Durer's Melancholia polyhedrons falling from the sky. They sweep the streets in Holland. Then I did a show, a postcard show and a Durer show kind of thing in the University of Nebraska. I had the curator send me postcards of things in the collection. And the Sheldon Art Museum at the University of Nebraska is one of the great collections of American art in our country. It's just incredible. And so he sent me these four postcards of their collection, and I painted Durer melancholic fragments over top of them. Those white borders were part of the postcard. They're the accurate fourth postcard. And but the major part of the show, here's Durer's Melancholia. Do you see the polyhedron on the left? And it's just this mysterious, there's been so much written about this print. It's this. And one of the theories about this print is that Durer was talking about the melancholy of the artist happens when theory doesn't, when practice doesn't kind of meet theory. And that fascinated me. But various parts of this print show up in a lot of my work ever since. I'm obsessed with it. The wing, you'll see later, the wing of the muse, the little bell at the top, there's a magic square, the sphere, the back of the dog I like a lot. And there's all these tools of the artist's work all around it. That little cartouche with melancholia on it is a bat wing. And I decided that melancholia, since it was all about art and art making and the artist, should be made out of art. So they let me use the collection to build versions of melancholia out of the artwork in the collection. And in the middle of the room was Durer's melancholia on a pedestal, so you can use it to decipher things. It's like playing games with the print. Did you notice there was like that painting reminded me of the muse, and there's a moon up in the print and various things, but sometimes they're more literary play, sometimes they're visual, sometimes, it works in multiple ways, otherwise they could be like kind of a series of one-liners. I forget the names of each one. There's three of them here. This is another one. I think this one's called Measure. I think the other one was, it says on the screen, but I'm not going to go over it. Here's another. That's a Picasso plate they let me put on the wall where the sphere is, and there's a early Wegman dog, and a Saul Witt where the magic square is, and it's a McCracken sculpture leaning against it where the ladder would be. Up in the sky is the Winslow Horn. Here they are in the room. I built a third one, and the dog with the Jeff Koons balloon dog, and you can see that, you get the idea. It was just a great project. And it took me a few years and three trips to the Sheldon to go through their whole collection, and they were like, incredible. It was the most wonderful thing to do and experience, to think that you can make art out of other people's art. Some of my friends said, what if they found out you were doing that with their work? Most of them are dead, I use postcards to make my own, these collages. And I was doing these all along. I'll show you a few that I was doing, those theater painted, printed ones. And they usually followed a format like this. Often the postcards would be turned sideways. One of the things I'm really interested in work is that you slow down the kind of ability to decipher it. And I like turning postcards sideways just to slow that down a little bit, because we think we can read a postcard so fast. These are, I did in Berlin. A lot of them are about, it was a lot of talk then about the East and West merger yet, even though it was a decade after. These are about 2006, so it's actually about 15 years later. I found a lot of this stuff in little flea market bookstalls and things in the city. These are all German postcards and from German engineering books. I really like the banality of these images. I don't know if you noticed it. And these are two of my favorite sort of failed images. I was looking for images that had like, where the subject was light poles. And both of these is like, there's this light pole that's like as important as anything else in the image. And that intrigued me, and this one's about those light poles. I forget the titles there. And this one though is about the Rhine, which isn't really in Berlin, but it's just another Berlin piece. This is a show, I'm not gonna show you too many more postcards, but collecting is central to what I do in my kind of research. And these are my motel postcards. This is a show I did in Breda, the Netherlands. And It's a display of 200 motel postcards. I have a collection of closer to 400 of them. And they're often failed postcards. I've written about them. We can talk later if you want. I don't have time to tell you much about how these postcards fail, but they're really interesting. Often the motels are separated from the viewer by a road and a field and all sorts of interesting things with wires and telephone poles. You get a little sense of it in some of these. Some of them you can barely see the motel. But showing this in the Netherlands, I had quite a crowd there, and my brother-in-law and I did each did a lecture on pleasure, and because it was part of our book, we were working on it at the time, the book Michael mentioned, and people actually found motels that they had stayed in. I mean, Dutch tourists, they got really excited. It's pretty funny. Anyway, I'll just slip by these a little bit. Those are signs that came off of the postcards. But more importantly to the work you're seeing, when I was in Berlin doing those postcard collages, I didn't do a lot of them. I did about 8 to 10 of them that summer, but I did a project for myself of making a collage or a drawing every day. They were pretty much always collages. And they were like this. And things I'd find, scraps of, like on the left, that came from a little catalog from a really cheaply printed from a well-known kind of record store in Berlin, and a kind of catalog of something like IKEA on the right. And that's a rubbing of the leaf of the chestnut tree outside my window. And I just did every day a collage. And someone mentioned Hangman the other day. I played Hangman with a little German boy. That's the scrap paper from it. And that's his shoelace from his shoe that I drew. And these are small. They're only, you know, barely a foot, maybe about 11 inches. These collages lead to the work you're seeing here. I think you can see that. It was really important to do that collage every day as a kind of journal, diary. And when I got back, I started working like mad. And this is more recent. This is my studio in Chicago. I threw these in. I mentioned this yesterday to the seniors that I always like seeing where people work when if they talk and you can see a studio. So this wasn't so long ago because there's a lot of the paintings that are in this show are here. It's a place where I could live in the back when I would come up from my job in Champaign 2 years ago. And that's where I had, after that trip to Berlin, in 2007 I started this series. This is a big painting, a 4x4 foot painting, and it's been painted over. I don't really have this painting anymore. I've added more, it seems sort of empty. I should have taken it out of the car. This is the one here in the show called Position. You can see the little Durer sign. And I was talking to a class earlier today about this painting. It started with a tent. And the tent made me think of that polyhedron. And then I was interested in this kind of. The tent came out of a catalog for camera equipment, real cheap little catalog with just little line drawings. And I like that the banality of that image and combining it with this intensely colored little mysterious reference to Durer. And what that polyhedron, nobody really knows what in the world that is saying in that piece. There's the Wing of the Muse. This is a 4x4 foot painting. Okay, so I should talk about the paintings a little. Stuff comes from all over the place in my paintings, like the collages. That's the connection. And there's different ways to paint in the same painting. In almost every painting, not all of them, but a lot of them have multiple languages of painting in the same painting. So that it's that kind of juxtaposition, that kind of conscious of that sort of painting about painting aspect of them. That knot and that wing of the muse talk to each other. Those are my guitar picks thrown on the canvas and traced and painted in. And I'm really interested in lots of ways to make paintings. I'll stencil things. I'll throw the guitar picks on and trace around. I'll trace things. I'll project things. I'll do little rubbing transfers onto my paintings. I'll download things from the internet. I'll collect magazine images. Things can come from anywhere. And they come from observation. I did a crude little quick drawing of the knot from a rope. So I just am completely eclectic about sources. And I think that's a really important thing to me. Renaissance and for most of Western history, paintings were thought of as windows. The Renaissance window, we refer to it, you know, looking into a painting is looking into a landscape as if you're looking through a window into space. And I thought, well, I put this on my painting, it'll be like a window. It's a Renaissance window. But at the same time, it's an acknowledgement of the 20th century idea that paintings are flat. And so with just putting that one bird on the painting surface, it seemed like I could talk about painting in both ways and at once. And I thought, I love that. And so I made those white marks that almost like reflective marks of some thick paint on it to break sort of some of the illusion of it, but also still to refer to it as a window. I forgot to put this in. This is called Fin, kind of obvious, but it's also wordplay. It comes out of that image of that, an earlier collage you saw, that rocket I found it in Berlin. Here's the kingfisher. Kingfisher is, every once in a while I'll paint something very representational for that moment of, you know, that language of painting, but to put it, the kingfisher on just pure paint. I just really like that kind of play. And that strange little structure that just was painted intuitively as a kind of another language of paint that maybe refers to the bird, maybe refers to the paint, maybe it's its own little model. But it's a very different language. So this is called Delft. I collect Delft tiles, among other things. Lots of different kinds of tiles, actually, from the 17th century. And those are little corner things. This sort of suggests four big tiles, and replacing the center images. This is Picnic. These are all in the show. Net. This one isn't. This is Fan, which is kind of referenced, obviously, to Joseph Albers. But I like the idea of a fan. It wasn't the idea that I'm a fan of Albers, which I later regretted titling it because that's what people think. But it's the idea that there's this rotating fan and there's his homage, you know, to the square, squares within squares within squares. And somehow I thought of that as a kind of spiraling thing and them both being kind of these forms that could talk to each other as forms. Here's all my colors, which is right here. It's every color on my palette, or on my table of tubes of paint that I had at the time. I think there's 50-some tubes there. And I, in a kind of speech bubble that's just painted by squeezing that out of the tube, too. It's all just painted with squeezing tubes, which is something I do a lot if you look around. Mostly when you see thick paint, I've pretty much squeezed it out of a tube or squeezed a couple colors together and then mushed it around with palette knife. This one is